a landscape formed by the gigantic glaciers of the Ice Age. Fjords characterize the coastline, looking like fingers of the ocean's hand gripping the rugged shore. A land with gentle valleys, flowing with wild, bubbling brooks. Countless waterfalls adorn the mountain cliffs. Majestic witnesses of thousands of years of history. All this is revealed by a journey through southern Norway, the land of the fjords. The Scandinavian country of Norway stretches from the capital city of Oslo in the southeast to far north of the Arctic Circle. Because of the Gulf Stream, Norway enjoys a much milder climate than its location in the northern part of Europe would suggest. But that was not always the case. The Jostedalbreen National Park gives an indication of what it must have been like during the past ice ages. The Jostedalbreen is the largest single unbroken glacier on the European continent. It extends for hundreds of kilometers in a north-south direction. More than 500 square kilometers of uninhabited ice expanse in the middle of Europe. The buildings making up this station are the only constructions on the glacier. They belong to the University of Oslo and are used for glacier and climate research. Here, it was discovered that the Jostedalbreen is not a leftover from the last ice age. The glacier is much too young. It formed during a period of cold about 500 years before the birth of Christ. The several dozen meter thick ice shield seems gigantic, and yet compared to the kilometer thick masses of ice of the ice ages, this glacier is very thin ice. Each day, tourists take the short boat ride across the meltwater lake to hike on the glacier. And each day, the glacier guides chop steps into the ice. So with spikes on their shoes and safely secured to a line, anyone can conquer the ice face of the glacier. Cracks in the ice present the greatest danger to those hiking on the glacier. They are not always as obvious as this one. Observed close up, the glacial ice shimmers a deep blue. That is caused by air trapped in the ice, which is compressed ever tighter by the weight of the frozen mass. Meltwater flows down from the glacier and collects under the ice against impenetrable cliffs. The unbelievable amount of meltwater lost is replaced by the snows of the following winter. So the glacier grows in the winter and shrinks in the summer. An annual cycle that is tending more and more towards the shrinkage side because of global warming. It then shoots out of the so-called glacier gate into the valley below. The melt-off feeds countless rivers and streams in the area of the Jostedal Green National Park. Also those on its southwestern border. One of Norway's most beautiful valleys is located here, the Lørne Valley. Like a picture out of a fairy tale, the Lovanet Lake lies nestled in the valley. The Lørne Valley is a very special place. There is always something new to be discovered, from its entry point to where it ends at the glacier. These small wooden huts serve as overnight lodgings. They are built in the old traditional style, with grass sod on the roof. The lake can be crossed comfortably in a small boat. On the opposite shore, a short hike takes one to the glacier, which lies only a bit above the water level of the lake. The Lørne Valley spreads before us peaceful and beautiful. Beautiful but dangerous, as the local historian Olaf Falaide explains.
Lovatnet fagert, og lovatnet farlig. Alle de steinene vi ser.
All of the massive rocks seen here were once part of the mountain itself. They broke away and fell during the landslides of 1905 and 1936. The lake was 90 meters deep at this point. Today, the rocks rise up to 1.5 meters above the surface of the water. The Lovanet has become the grave of 92 people who were swept away by the floods and never found. Nine successful farms operated in the hamlet of Nesdal. No one lives there anymore. Today, the Lørne Valley is a vacation spot for the descendants of the survivors and, of course, for local and foreign tourists. All are struck by the valley's incredible beauty. The memorial plaque still stands in memory of the victims of that catastrophic landslide. 92 of them found their last resting place in the Lovanet. Our journey takes us through the small village of Strin, and then northwest over the Jotunheimen. Translated, the name means home of the giants, referring to Norway's tallest mountains. Apart from crystal clear mountain lakes, snow still lies in some depressions in the landscape. The snow remains all summer long and compresses to form small glaciers. It's no wonder the temperatures up here are significantly lower than at sea level, and the weather can change from one moment to the next. Anyone wanting a snow guarantee during the summer only needs to follow the snow road to the south. If it is passable at all, then only in the summer. Several meters of snow cover the ground during the winter months. Tunnels have been cut through the mountains to make the towns in the valleys accessible by car during the winter. The Lærdal Tunnel, completed in 2000, is the longest automobile tunnel in the world. Futuristic, beautiful blue fluorescent lights, spaced every couple of kilometers, help drivers stay alert during the seemingly never-ending journey through this 24.5-kilometer-long tunnel. Before the tunnels, many towns were only accessible by sea during the winter months. The best way to explore a fjord is to take a boat cruise. A passage takes one from Åland on the Åland Fjord to Gudvangen at the end of the Nærøy Fjord and back. The trip takes about 3 hours, but one can also disembark at the halfway point at the harbor of Gudvangen. Cruise ships from all over the world offer their guests the special experience of a fjord cruise. Where else in the world can one travel deep into the interior of a country by sea? The steep cliff faces tower up to 1,500 meters above the level of the sea. The Nærøy Fjord is Norway's most narrow fjord. At its most narrow point, it is only about 13 meters wide. Beautiful and dangerous creatures live in the waters of the fjord. The lion mane jellyfish has thousands of microscopic stinging capsules. They are dangerous weapons. The pressure inside the capsules is 70 times greater than that of an automobile tire. Thus, they easily penetrate a crab shell, injecting a paralyzing poison into their prey. In humans, the poison of the lion mane jellyfish causes an uncomfortable burning on the skin. The sea devil carries a particularly ominous name. It is considered to be a delicacy by fish lovers, but very few people know the predator behind the name. The sea devil's enormous mouth hints at its voracious appetite. In contrast to the lion mane jellyfish, he lurks motionlessly, waiting for his prey to chance by. The fringes around his mouth blend its outline into the ocean floor. Thus camouflaged, he waits, motionless, for his next victim. Even sharks are found in the Norwegian fjords. This young, small, spotted cat shark just hatched from its egg a few days ago. Now it is looking for something to eat. A crab like this would certainly taste good to the shark. But the crab has nothing to fear until the shark is fully grown. The young shark has to keep looking. The curtain of poisonous stinging tendrils of the jellyfish is a deadly barrier for the small shark. His hunger drives him on. First hesitantly, but then with growing confidence, he continues, swimming over the jellyfish and thus overcoming the deadly danger. Cat sharks live on the ocean floor and avoid energy-intensive swimming whenever possible. He wants to get back to the bottom quickly, blind to lurking dangers. Fortune smiles on the shark. Completely exhausted, the shark first takes time to rest. While the sea devil again does his name all justice and waits for his next victim. The Hardanger Vidda is Europe's largest high plateau. It spreads out over nearly 8,000 square kilometers. Since 1981, the Hardanger National Park takes up about 3,500 square kilometers of that area. The glaciers of the Ice Age carved out the plateau, resulting in its current form. An ideal place for hiking. Small huts provide inviting places to stop for a rest. Here, as everywhere else in Norway, camping is allowed even outside designated camping areas, but it is only advisable during the summer. The trail markers in the passes indicate how high the snow is in the winter. Besides various wild animals, countless goats also graze on the high plateau. Here they find abundant fodder and forage untended during the daylight hours. Mosses and lichens make up many of the 450 different types of plants growing here. Few flowering plants are able to survive in the barren soil. Of those, the cotton grass is especially noteworthy. Long fibers covering its seeds form a fluffy head. The plants thrive here thanks to the high level of moisture in the soil. The winter's melt-off collects in shallow lakes. They are characteristic of the Hardanger Vidda. The outflow forms good-sized brooks and streams. Much of the melt-off ends up falling into the Vøringfossen. The water shoots out into the depths at a rate of a bit more than 12 cubic meters per second. The Vøringfossen is the best known of Norway's waterfalls and one of the most frequently visited. The water cascades 143 meters in freefall before joining the waters below. The total height of the falls is 183 meters. Springtime comes to the valleys while the mountains are still covered in snow. In Hardanger, apple plantations begin to blossom on the slopes of the fjord. The apple trees stand shoulder to shoulder over broad expanses. The land around the Hardanger Fjord is one of the best areas in Norway for growing cherries. The juicy fruit hang in large bunches. So many cherries are produced here each year that Norwegian cherries are exported to all of Scandinavia. The tarpaulins protect the ripe fruit from rainfall. Otherwise, the heavy drops would cause the cherries to burst and ruin their market value. The cherries growing in the garden of Stina's parents are not for sale. She likes to pick the juicy cherries, and not only because she knows that her mother will be making a delicious cherry cake for the neighborhood children. The children can hardly believe their eyes. In just a short time, the delicious treat is ready and waiting for them. Whipped cream and walnuts are traditionally served with this Norwegian cherry delicacy. But how the cake is formed is left entirely up to the imagination. There is hardly a mountain in Norway that doesn't have its waterfall. This is the Steindalfossen. It is a good example of how a waterfall changes over the seasons of the year. In the spring, the streams leading to it are fed by melt-off. At that time, several cubic meters of water per second shoot over the Steindalfossen Falls with enormous force. By contrast, the mighty waterfall seems to be just a trickle during the summer. But the Steindalfossen offers more. One can get behind a waterfall and gaze outward through the flowing watery curtain. At one time, there were more than 1,000 stave churches in Norway. Today, only 28 of those remain. King Olaf Tryggvason was the first Viking king to unite all the smaller kingdoms. But after his death, his kingdom dissolved again very quickly. Not until King Olaf II did this bold endeavor succeed again, and Christianity played a decisive role. Even as this new religion had only one God, the country should also have only one king. The stave church in Borgund and the one in Hedal are the best preserved of their kind. The Vikings used their knowledge of shipbuilding in the construction of the stave churches. Heathen carvings decorate the Christian church. Snake designs above the doors were to provide protection for the church. The mythological creatures with human heads on the doorposts also serve to guard the church. The carved dragon heads on the gables symbolize protection for the church. And many crosses were also thought to provide the church with greater protection from evil spirits. The largest of the Norwegian stave churches is also known as the Wooden Cathedral. It sits on a stone foundation to keep the wood from rotting. In addition, even up to the present day, the wood is treated with tar according to medieval tradition in order to protect the church, built in the 12th century, from decay. The trellised arbor surrounds the main nave of the church. This is where the faithful believers would lay their weapons before entering the church sanctuary. The roof construction, resembling the hull of a ship, is 26 meters high. The main nave of the church is about 20 meters long. The altar was built in the 17th century, the same time the works of art on the walls were done. The rose patterns are much older and adorn almost the entire nave. Heathen carvings can be found here as well. Carvings from the Nibelungen sagas decorate the 12th century bishop seat. The journey takes us back to the coast. Cherries are scattered off the coast of Norway. These small islands are actually tips of mountains. They have been eroded by glaciers and today barely jut above the surface of the ocean. They vary in size from just a few square meters to several square kilometers. Navigating between the skerries requires special skills. Boats coming into a harbor like that of Bergen used to be required to have a local pilot on board. Bergen is Norway's second largest city. According to the sagas, this city of a quarter million inhabitants was founded by King Olaf Kyrre. The oldest historical documents relating to a settlement in the natural harbor of Vagen date back to around 1130. This natural harbor is deep enough to allow even the largest cruise ships to anchor here. Easy access to the ocean helped Bergen open its first Hanseatic trading offices in 1343. A separate city quarter quickly developed, Tiskbrigen, the German loading docks. Through the Hanseatic businessmen, Bergen was able to benefit from the wealth of the Hanseatic League, even though it was not an official Hansa city. Cities with Hanseatic trading offices could not be included in the Hanseatic League. Bergen was subject to the German Hanseatic city of Lübeck. In the heyday of the Hanse, nearly a fourth of Bergen's population was German. Behind the shining facades, one has the feeling of having gone back in time. Here one finds the wooden warehouses and Hanseatic business offices. Even today, they serve as places of business or cultural meeting places. Bergen's fish market has become an institution. Every type of seafood is offered here. Everything from fresh salmon to sea devil or whole crabs. This stand is especially well loved by foreign tourists. Students come here from every country in the world and sell fish here in several different languages. So, customers can purchase their chosen delicacies in their own language. Most popular is fresh vacuum-packed salmon, although some customers certainly wouldn't mind buying a kiss either. The village of Geiranger, with its 300 inhabitants, is world-renowned. It lies at the end of the fjord with the same name. The Geiranger Fjord is by far the most frequently visited fjord in Norway. Each year, more than 100 cruise ships steam into the fjord. The looming flanks of the mountain seem almost endless. And yet, the Geiranger Fjord is only about 15 kilometers long. From the platform of the narrow needle of rock, the view from Freidalsuvet is breathtaking. The journey through the land of the fjords ends here. Further north, the untamed wilderness of northern Norway begins.